Please welcome to the stage PwC Digital Content Manager, Raquel Quintana.
Hello, how's everybody doing today? I like that energy. All right.
Hi, everyone. My name is Raquel Quintana. I've had the pleasure of working with PwC's Access Your Potential team for over a year, and we're super excited to be here with you all today. So you might be wondering, what is Access Your Potential? What are all these cards doing on your table? And honestly, if I could go back to my freshman or sophomore year of college, I wish I would be sitting in a room exactly like this, learning about a program like Access Your Potential, and I'll tell you why. So my family is originally from New Mexico. I moved to New York City on my own at 18 for school. So I was a full-time student supporting myself, pursuing a career in an industry that my community didn't really know much about. My parents didn't have any connections or strings they could pull to get me my foot in the door somewhere. So at times I felt like I was navigating adulthood and the professional world all on my own. Like, I knew I needed to get more experience, get involved on campus, find an internship, but I also had to work X amount of hours to pay my bills, and a lot of internships were unpaid. I wanted to seek advice from people who looked like me and had a story similar to people in my community, but I just feel I didn't have access to people that were in rooms that I wanted to be in one day. So feel free to raise your hand if you can relate to any of this. Who's looking for an internship, not really sure where to start, possibly interested in finding a mentor? So what is Access Your Potential? PwC's Access Your Potential program is rooted in the belief that access should be a right, not a privilege. We want to see a workforce that is reflective of the diversity of current US college students and diversity that's even reflected in this room today. So Access Your Potential is a free career prep and mentorship program for Black, Hispanic, and Latinx college students. It is open to all years, all majors. There are no prerequisites required to sign up and no commitments after signing up. It's very much a choose your own adventure type of program. When you sign up, you gain access to a bunch of different program resources, and I like to break them down into three distinct categories. So we have our online self-led interactive learning, we have our mentorship program, and then access to career opportunities like paid externship nonprofit programs. So our career readiness curriculum walks you through topics like building your personal brand, enhancing your networking skills. Our hands-on learning digital skills curriculum, you get to learn concepts of human-centered design, data visualization, ethical AI, and cybersecurity. The next piece of Access Your Potential, and the part that I get most excited about, is our mentorship program. So January is actually National Mentoring Month, so let's see who can finish this sentence. Your network is your net. There we go. So if you self-identify as Black, Hispanic, or Latinx, you'll have access to our mentorship program that matches you up with mentors from all different backgrounds. You can meet regularly with your mentor one-on-one or in a group pod setting, or you can take advantage of our flash mentoring where you can get immediate questions answered like, what should I be doing my freshman and sophomore year to prepare for a career in this field? Or what does your day-to-day really look like in your job? I'm kind of interested, but really, what does the day-to-day entail? So Access Your Potential is designed for you to get whatever you need out of the program. We understand you already have a lot on your plate, so we're here to support you, not add more to your plate. We host virtual discussions on topics like what it's like being a first-gen college student, managing personal finances and scholarships, and we also host virtual and in-person networking events, some of which we've hosted at PwC offices. And what's really important about this program to remember is that you do not have to be interested in working at PwC or in the professional services sector. This is really built to equip students from all backgrounds who are interested in any career path with the skills and confidence that employers are looking for across all industries. So if you do want to learn more about Access Your Potential or you're ready to jump in, feel free to scan the QR code on the postcards in front of you. Once again, there is no commitment after signing up, but after you sign up, you'll just have access to all of our resources.
Also, fun fact, PwC launched their first ever TikTok channel, which is kind of huge for us. We feature college and career advice videos from our mentors, partners, interns, and students who we meet at college events just like this. So we'd love to hear from you. You know, what advice would you give your younger self? What advice would you give to incoming freshmen on making friends your first semester? How do you prioritize your mental health as a college student? You know, there is no dancing required to be featured on our TikTok channel, and we really believe that everyone in this room has a unique story and perspective that we really value, so we'd love to hear from you. I'll have a table set up outside of this room, so after, feel free to stop by the table if you have any questions about Access Your Potential or you want to pick from one of our prompts to be featured on our TikTok channel. And now I have the pleasure of welcoming back our next speaker exploring inclusive leadership and unbiased decision making, Matt Meuleners.
Thanks everybody, and thanks again to Raquel and to PwC for sponsoring this session. Really excited to be back with you. We're gonna have what I think is a really interesting conversation and hopefully a really useful one. But this is not going to be a session where I just talk at you. So as a preview, parts of what we do in here are gonna be interactive. They're gonna involve having conversations with people around you. And so I wanna make sure, because I can't see you super well, who's all still with us, that you have people near you that you can talk to. So here's what I'm gonna ask. Anybody who's in, let's say, the back third of the room, I'm gonna ask you to get up now and move up to the front half of the room and find some spots, tables that are a little less full, and work your way in so that we've got at least five people at any table so that you can have a rich conversation about some of the things that we're gonna discuss. So if you're camped out near the back, our time of assigned seating is long past. There's not gonna be any sessions after this. So come on up and join us, join a table, introduce yourselves. And before we jump into our discussion, I want to invite you, because again, you're going to be talking to some other people in the room, some people at your table, invite you to take a moment to introduce yourself to some of the folks who are sitting with you or around you. So let's just take a quick 2 minutes, say hi to the people at your table. Who are you? Where are you from? Maybe something interesting you learned during the executive mentor experience, and I'll grab you again here in just under 2 minutes to begin. All right, my hope is that at this point you've had a chance to at least say hi to the folks at your table. I want to take a moment, just quickly introduce myself. So my name is Matt Meuleners. I'm one of the partners at a company called Focus Training. We are a leadership development firm based in the Midwest, serving clients all over North America. What we do is help organizations build their leadership pipelines. What does that mean? Basically, as talented employees move through their careers in an organization, there are certain transitions that happen in your career depending on what path you choose to take. And those transitions can be really tough if you're not being prepared with the new skill sets you need to get there. So one of those big transitions is with what we call high potentials, if you remember that term from the executive mentor experience. This is a moment in a lot of people's careers where we go from being a strong individual contributor, right? Somebody who is excellent in our role. Maybe you're a buyer, or maybe you're in cybersecurity, and you get really good at doing that job. Well, a lot of organizations look at high performers and they think, maybe they have the potential to do more. And then you might find yourself promoted into a role where you now have leadership responsibilities, either formal leadership responsibilities, where now you have people reporting directly to you, you've got employees that you're responsible for, or sometimes, and much more commonly now, informal leadership responsibilities, where while somebody doesn't necessarily report to you, you don't have to do their performance review at the end of the year, you are now in a position of influence where you need to make things happen in the organization, persuade people to move in certain directions or inspire action in others. But the transition from individual contributor to leader is really tough for a lot of folks because it introduces an entirely new skill set. So if you were really good at cybersecurity and suddenly someone says, hey, now you lead the cybersecurity team, that's a different set of skills that you need to be prepared for. Suddenly you have to be able to have a tough conversation with an employee or to motivate a group of people or to help people work through change that's coming down through the organization. The list goes on and on. Unfortunately, in some organizations, there's not much in place to provide that upskilling and support for new leaders, and that's where we come in. We just slide right into those organizations and fill in that gap. We also get involved with organizations when they are preparing folks for senior leadership or strategic leadership. Because if you've been a manager for a long time, you've led teams or maybe even led a retail location or a department or a business unit, tactical leadership might be something you're very good at and experienced at, but leading at a strategic level takes a different kind of thinking. Suddenly you're thinking about culture. You're thinking about reacting enterprise-wide to crisis. You're collaborating with people who do very different work from you, for you. You're interacting with things on a different scale. And so that's another place where we get involved with the leadership development within organizations. Now, what this has meant for me in my career is that I've spent the last 23 years working with leaders of all kinds, every level in organizations and across all industries and industry sectors. So certainly in retail, but also in healthcare and tech and heavy manufacturing and nonprofit and education and all over the place. And what I have come to understand is that the people problems are largely the same. We're all doing different work, but once you get that leadership hat on, some of these basics are universal. How you apply them in your own world is different. But that's one of the reasons that we approach our training the way that we do. So when I said earlier, this is not just going to be me talking at you, you're going to need to talk to each other a little bit. That's because we have come to recognize that when we're working on leadership skills, you will learn more from other people around you, or maybe as much from other people around you who are practicing this, doing this, than you will from some guy sitting on a stage. So today what we're gonna do is talk about some big ideas, some principles. I'll share some stories and examples from my own career and experience and some of the organizations that we work with. But I'm also gonna ask you and challenge you to have some open conversations with people at your tables about what you've seen in the jobs that you may already have, what you've seen in maybe some of the classrooms and the discussions that you've had with people, and what you see out there in industry. As many of you, I think, are observers of industry, whether you're in it yet or not, want to have a conversation about this in a few different ways. One of the ways we'll do that is through a thought experiment that we'll get to in a little bit. But I just wanted to set the tone because we're going to be talking today about something that is, by its very nature, challenging. It's challenging for everybody. When you are confronting your own bias, it is a hard thing to do, because what we are literally going to talk about today is how to look at something that up to this point may have been a blind spot. That takes effort. It takes self-reflection. Sometimes it takes a little courage. But it is incredibly important. And I also want to say at the top of this, while a lot of what we will talk about is going to rhyme with and run parallel to the work that professionals in diversity, equity, and inclusion work are doing, I am not a DEI expert. But I'm talking about this subject with leaders all the time. Because at this point in our journey as a society and in our journey as a workforce, companies are starting to recognize, finally, that DEI is not something you do over here and just have programs in. But we have to do all the things that we do as leaders and as businesses and as organizations and as teams with these principles baked into them. We're starting to recognize you can't be a leader and work on inclusivity. You have to be an inclusive leader. You can't be a business that's selling products and has some initiatives around diversity. We have to be a business selling products to a diverse marketplace and recognizing how that plays out. So we're going to talk today about bias, but we're going to talk about it from the lens of leadership. One of the reasons that we need to have a more inclusive mindset is that it makes us better decision makers. We're not doing it to be nice. We're not doing it because it's the right thing to do. Actually, we should do that. We should do it because it's the right thing to do. But also, selfishly, this helps you make smarter decisions. And this is the thing that businesses are waking up to. Right? We don't do it because it gives us good PR. We do it because if we recognize blind spots in our decision making, we make better decisions, smarter decisions, and we succeed. That's what we're going to talk about today. So, the very first thing that we need to do is talk about bias. What are we talking about? We're going to talk about unconscious bias specifically today, but I do want to be clear, bias doesn't have to be unconscious. Not everything is a blind spot. There are plenty of biases that we walk around with that we are totally conscious of. I'll give you an example. I went to undergrad at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. Any Badgers in here? What's up? I see you. Best school. Yeah, that's the best school. All your other schools are very good, I'm sure. But there's only one best school. There can only be one best school, and that's the school I went to, right? That's a conscious bias of mine. I know about it. It's not a blind spot of mine. I'm aware that I have a preference for the University of Wisconsin-Madison. There's good reasons that I have that preference, because I had a great experience there. However, it is still a bias, even though I'm conscious of it. Is it based on sound statistical facts? No, it is not. Sorry, Badgers. It is not. There is very little evidence to suggest scientifically that the University of Wisconsin-Madison is the best university that anyone could go to. Was it a good experience for me? 100%. Do I recommend it to people? I do. But what I am talking about right now is a conscious bias of mine. It is an aspect of my worldview, an opinion that I have settled on, that does in some cases shape my decisions and behaviors, but it's one that I am fully aware of. And it happens to be a favorable bias. But what we're going to talk about a little bit more today are unconscious biases. Those things that are shaping our decision making, shaping the way that we make decisions, the way that we act, the way that we react, our behaviors, without our awareness, without even recognizing that they're influencing the way that we do things. Sometimes, as I said, those biases can be favorable, and sometimes they can be unfavorable. So just as I have my favorite school, there were also some rivalries. I'm not going to call any of those specific schools out right now in case you're from there. But one of my very good friends decided to go to business school at one of these rivalries. The color blue is involved. I'll just put it that way. And he and I have let's call it a festive rivalry between the two of us. And it calls me into talking a lot of smack about his university. Is that appropriate? No, but it's just between two people. It's just between friends. Favorable, unfavorable, either is possible when we talk about bias. But when it comes to unconscious bias, the point is it's a blind spot for us. We're not aware of it. These biases sometimes happen very quickly. But for unconscious bias in particular, it tends to build up slowly over time through what we call socialization. Socialization is simply through our lived experience over time, we develop an aspect of our worldview. In other words, the more experience we have, the more life we live, the more our brain starts to decide, I know what the world looks like. Now, the good news for you is, I think, for the most part, you're substantially younger than me. So your brains still have a lot more flexibility. Your worldview is far less concrete than mine is. And so it is easier for you to flex out of some of this socialization. The bad news is, if you don't recognize that that socialization exists, then you can't tackle this because unconscious biases don't get fixed. until we make them conscious and then address what they're built on. So that's the journey. When we talk about the journey around bias, the work that needs to be done, it's about first pulling our biases from unconscious into conscious, and then evaluating those biases to ask, what are they built on? Is it built on real evidence? Is it built on facts that I can base my opinions on? Or did this just accumulate over time? Was it just what I heard from other people around me while I was growing up? Is it based on one anecdotal experience I had that now I've just projected into every interaction that I'll have for the rest of my life? Or am I just totally ignorant of this thing? I mentioned this earlier in the executive mentor experience, but 7 years ago when we were in a different room at the time at the Javits Center, but we were just starting to talk about the impact of social media, and we still had people in the room asking questions like, do you think people will really buy clothes online? Think about the bias baked into that way of thinking. Had folks who at that time had been working in retail for 30 years and they had lived experience that had baked a certain view in their mind about what retail is and how things work and who will buy what. You have people in this space who say things like, I would never wear that, so nobody would wear that. I would never buy that, so nobody's gonna buy that. Right? They're making tangible business decisions and not always recognizing the impact of their own worldview on those decisions, and in many cases then missing opportunities. So that's what we're on about today. Our goal is to think about this meta skill that will equip you not just for your future when you're the one sitting in those strategic boardrooms or trying to make decisions for a business, but also that you can put to work right now for some of the most important decisions you will make for your entire career. The next 3-4 years of your life, you're gonna make some of the biggest, most important decisions. So how do we make those decisions as well-informed as possible? How do we make those decisions as clear-eyed as possible with as much information as possible? That's the mission. There are lots of different kinds of bias. It comes in different sizes and shapes and flavors. These are just a few examples that we talk about with leaders and managers in organizations a lot. As I talk about these, I want you to think about examples from your own life, because these crop up all the time, not just at work. They crop up in our interactions and our relationships all the time. But these are some of the most common. So affinity bias is one. This is very common, very simple. This is a preference for those who we feel like are similar to us. You don't have to look any farther than the middle school lunchroom to see this on display. Right? You walk in and everybody's sitting in little pockets and you can kind of tell, okay, there's the Dungeons and Dragons geeks. Let's see if my people are out there. Okay. This happens in businesses all the time too, right? There's a sense of safety and comfort if we feel like we can relate to people. And there's challenges that come with that, of course, as well. Confirmation bias is a big one. This one's always very frustrating to me when I encounter it, but confirmation bias is when we've already decided, right? If you've ever sat down in a conversation with your friends or with a boss, or maybe you're talking to a professor about something that you're gonna do or not do, and you can just tell they've already made a decision and the only things they're listening to are the arguments that are in favor of the decision they've already made. And we're showing preference for evidence that reinforces what we already think. Social media echo chamber, anyone? Same idea, right? I know things, and so I'm gonna just immerse myself in things that support what I already decided. Attribution bias is an interesting one. If you've ever been driving on the freeway and somebody cuts you off, immediately in your head, you got a story about that person, right? They probably weren't raised very well. They're probably a bad human being in general. They probably hate kittens, right? You got lots of ideas about this person and their intent. Without actually knowing their intent, we write a story about somebody else's intent, the why behind their behavior. This one, spoiler alert, also poisons personal relationships a lot. Many of you have been involved in friendship or relationship drama that's built on this, that we attribute intent to someone's behavior or someone's words without actually confirming it or finding out for sure why they did what they did. It's an extremely common bias, extremely difficult on a team or in any relationship. Conformity bias is another one we talk about a lot in organizations. You know, for the last 15, 20 years, every organization has been talking about culture. We want to have a strong culture. We want to have an authentic culture. We want, right, this cultural mantra has been such a big part of conversations and organizations. And finally, for the first time, we're starting to recognize some of the danger that came with that. We were creating monocultures in organizations. Companies that were trying so hard to build this strong culture were accidentally building uniformity. We were avoiding hiring great talent because they weren't a culture fit. And we were worried they wouldn't fit in. Because of conformity bias, a lot of folks came into organizations and changed who they were or pretended to be someone else so that they could fit in. And what we lose in that process is the value, the benefit of diversity that we were seeking in the first place. This also comes up in business ethics. I've worked with organizations who have folks come in and look around and realize, oh, I guess the people around me don't follow the rules. I learned the rules. I was told in orientation that the rules were important, but nobody here is actually following the rules. So what do you prioritize? All of you could make a pretty safe bet on that one, right? Doesn't matter if you know the right thing to do and you were told the right thing to do. Spend enough time on a team that's not doing the right thing every single day, people slip. Halo and horn bias is an interesting one, and it's one that you will want to pay close attention to, especially early in your career. This is first impression bias. Every teacher in this room has experienced this, even if you're a really good person. First day of class, you identify your rock star students, you identify your troublemakers. And once they're labeled that way, it's really hard to shake that label. Because once I've decided you're a troublemaker, now everything you do passes through that lens. Anything you do that might be kind of ambiguous, right? You were a little loud today. And if you're one of my rock star students, maybe that just means you were really excited about today's topic. But if I've already identified you as a troublemaker, being loud gets translated really differently. And suddenly we find ourselves in tracks. This happens in companies too. Come in early, your first impression with a leader is not great. You might find that sticking to you. If leaders aren't trained to make decisions while evaluating their own bias. And then last, but certainly not least, probably the newest or the fastest growing bias that we are talking about in the companies that we work with and the leaders that I support is proximity bias. Many of you will head out into your careers and will be in hybrid or fully remote roles. And what we are already seeing as a challenge for organizations is that leaders put more energy into and put a higher priority on folks they see on a regular basis. Is it fair? No, that's why we're talking about it. But if I see you in the office every day versus somebody else who works in a different time zone and I only see them on Zoom or Teams a couple hours a week, guess who I am more likely to recommend for a promotion or to sign up for a cool opportunity or to reach out to work on a stretch project? If I'm not thinking about it, my bias kicks in. And fundamentally, all of these are examples of exactly that. They are examples of leaders and individuals making decisions without intention, without critical thought. We're just making them. And when we just make a decision, our brain relies on bias. It's what I often refer to in my career as lazy brain syndrome. You're not actually a lazy person, but your brain is. Your brain is wired for efficiency. It is constantly seeking the path of least resistance. It's trying to spend as few calories as possible to get things done. And so anytime it can resort to default or habit, anytime it can put itself on autopilot, it's going to do it. If you are not using your prefrontal cortex, your executive function, to grab hold of that decision and say, no, I want to think this through, or if you're not giving yourself the time to think it through, to truly reflect in a space where you can. How many of you are stupid busy right now, like in your life? Overprogrammed, running around, exhausted half the time. That mental state is one that feeds this kind of decision making. Your prefrontal cortex needs time and it needs space for you to slow down and make decisions with intention. But we often get confused, especially high performers get confused on this. I work with thousands of them every year. We think we get ahead by doing all the time. I can't just sit and think. I got stuff to do. And those are the folks that burn bright for about a year or two and then burn out. Start making bad decisions, get stuck early in their career. The folks who learn a cadence of reflection and learning how to break their brains out of these biases do a lot better. All right, it's time for me to shut my mouth for a little bit and give you a chance to talk. You've got these six examples of kinds of bias on the screen. All of these are fair game for you to talk about. Have you seen examples of this kind of bias in your personal relationships, in your educational experience, in your work experience, if you have it? What does this look like in the real world? What have you seen? Or have you seen types of bias that are not represented on this list? This is not an exhaustive list. We could go on and on and on. But I want you to talk about not the content, the context. What does this actually look like in the real world? I'm gonna give you about 5 minutes to chat about it, and then I'll be looking for maybe a couple examples from the audience. Let's talk. All right, my friends, I'm interested in hearing an example or two that you might have come up with at your table. Hey, do you mind? Go ahead and stand up for me, please, and just yell it out.
Okay. One thing that my group talked about was kind of like clubs and organizations on campus, when you're going through a recruitment sort of scenario, whether that's for like social or an actual business organization, is both the affinity bias and the conformity bias. When, like, let's say you're interviewing someone to join your organization, obviously you're going to click with someone that is similar to you because you actually talk on a deeper level versus someone you might not have a lot in common with. You're going to be like biased towards not allowing them to join your organization. So it puts both the diversity of your organization at risk and they would stop.
Excellent. That's a great example. Thank you so much. So in the same way that companies are figuring this out, right, that if we don't do our hiring with intention, if we're not recruiting for a company with intention, we can end up with a whole bunch of people that look alike, sound alike, think alike, and we miss out on the value of that diversity. The same is true when you're recruiting for your student organizations, the different clubs and activities that you're a part of. And what I love that you identified here is that it's so easy to do. It feels natural because I make a connection with you, right? We just click. It's easy to talk to you. Well, duh. Because you're not challenging to talk to. We're similar, we think similarly, we communicate similarly. It doesn't feel challenging to talk to you, but we confuse that for, oh, then that means you'll be a contributor. So what we're starting to see is organizations even reframe how we talk about this. Instead of saying, I'm looking for a culture fit, we say, I'm looking for a culture add. I'm looking for someone who will contribute to our growing culture, right? And that hopefully pushes us into a different mindset about this. How about one more? Is there one more person to be willing to share an example that you talked about at your table? Go for it. Stand up for me, please. Yeah, so that I'll repeat it back to the group, but just.
We talked about halo bias, and like a quote I really like about relationships is that you can't see red flags when you're wearing rose-colored glasses. So like, I mean, I don't know about you guys, but like I've been in some like toxic relationships before.
Some. Okay, we got
there's a list. Not multiple. Yeah.
All right, good. All right.
Anyway.
But yeah, like, but you checked the box.
When you're in it, it's really hard to get out of like the tunnel vision that like you think like, oh, this person is like for me. This person's like, they're my match or my soulmate. But like, if you take a step back and look at it sometimes, like, it ain't that way, you know?
So. Oh, I like this. I like this. We're eye to eye on this. This is a great example. And also, I feel you. I've been in love 3 times in my life. 2 of them, I was deeply confused. There's some real truth to this, right? This shows up in every kind of relationship. We're talking about your professional relationships today, but it's all over the place. And this is fundamentally about learning to think. Learning to think intentionally. Giving ourselves the time and space and reflection to step away and go, oh, she's crazy. Crazy hot, but also crazy, right? It was hard, it's hard, right? So these exist, right? They exist all over the place. And we can do something about it. We can tackle it. But the first step in the process for ourselves is reflection and analysis. You have to start taking a hard look at the way that you have been socialized because of who you are, because of the life that you've lived, because of the people that you've interacted with, the places that you've been, the experiences you've had. All of those shape your world. So what you see on the screen are just some examples of the kinds of things that shape our worldview. And what you'll notice probably is in the center circle are a lot of the big things that we talk about a lot in corporate DEI conversations and conferences and things like that, and in a lot of social justice movements. And there's a reason that we talk about them a lot, because they are significant and they've had a huge impact on the well-being of a lot of people in our country and in our world. But they are not the only things that shape who you are and shape your worldview. In fact, we would need a much bigger slide if we were to try to tackle all of it. But all of these things can and do create bias in the way that we see the world. And this is a moment where we should acknowledge that bias in and of itself is not the problem. It's the start of the problem, but it's not the problem. Bias is impossible to avoid as a starting position, because you only get to have one life experience. You can only see the world from that lived experience. There is literally not a way for me, as a cis white male in my 40s, to understand, truly understand, what it is like to be you. I can't. I cannot understand that, because I can't live your life. What I can do is learn more about it, ask questions, get curious, and recognize the fact that every decision I make requires me to make assumptions about other people, right? The only way I can try to make a decision fairly, equitably, inclusively about people who are different, if it's going to affect people that are different from me, really anyone who's not me, I have to make assumptions about what it's like to be you, what the impact of this decision might be on you. I have to make assumptions. There's no other way. It's the only path I have available to me. So the question is, then, are those assumptions based on good information? Or am I making lazy assumptions? Am I making easy assumptions? Or am I not bothering at all to consider your perspective? So is bias at the root of the problem? It's the start of the problem, but it isn't the whole problem. All of us are biased. We are limited by our own life experience, what we've seen, what we know, what we understand. In order to become more inclusive leaders and more inclusive decision makers, we have to practice acknowledging that and then getting as much information as we can so that we can make well-informed assumptions about others. Make sense? So for you personally, is there a box on this screen that you could think a little bit more about? There's a lot of things on here that impact our worldview. If you grew up in a family where everybody that you know has gone to a four-year college and had a post-secondary education that looked like that, do you think you're fully aware of how you perceive people who don't take that path? If you come from a family with a certain income background, high socioeconomic status, low socioeconomic status, golden toilets, I don't know. Do you really understand what it's like to be somebody who's in a very different situation? If you grew up around here, many years ago at this conference, we were doing a Q&A in one of these sessions, and somebody asked, they raised their hand and they asked, if I want to be successful, if I want to have a successful career in retail, do I need to move to New York? Interesting question. This person was from Chicago, and I was like, I don't know how to answer that. But it is an interesting bias to consider, right? Is that a proximity bias thing? If you're from the Midwest, can you just not, you just don't get it, or you can't connect or be successful, right? What are the biases that you may be carrying around without even thinking about it? Maybe you never even examined it. I've spent a lot of time doing this in my own journey lately. I'll give you one fairly vulnerable example. One of my best friends, who I mentioned earlier, is a guy named AJ Watson. AJ and I have a very similar resume. We went to similar schools, we did similar things. AJ and I actually went to high school together. We're still very close. Our careers paralleled each other for quite a long time. We did similar things. He's got two kids, I've got two kids. His oldest is named Gabrielle, my oldest is named Gabriel. Like, this is the kind of relationship we have. AJ and I have had very similar career success. Like, if you lined up where we sit today, what we get paid, our level of authority in an organization, our influence, on and on and on, a lot of that would line up. We're very similar in a lot of ways. The biggest visible difference you would see between AJ and I is that AJ is black. And for a long time, I thought to myself, we both came up in the same community, we both did a lot of the same things, we both worked the same to get what we achieved. I'm a hard worker, he's a hard worker, look what we made happen. It's only been in the last several years that I've really confronted the truth that AJ probably worked a lot harder than me to get to where he is, even with all the advantages that he had. He grew up in an upper middle class household. One of his parents went to college. There was experience there, a community with a lot of support and resources. But fundamentally, the more I educate myself about this, the more I have to confront the challenging fact that I didn't get to this place, the same place as AJ Watson, by working as hard. I started 15 yards ahead of him in the foot race. And that has changed the way that I think about him and his accomplishments and the way that I interact with him. And it's changed the way that I have to humbly confront the success that I've created in my life and what I try to do for others. I didn't wake up one day and magically realize that. I had to read a lot, talk to people a lot, reflect a lot. But it does change the way that I make decisions as I start to realize this more and more. What are you going to challenge yourself to think about? Every person in this room has got several things on this slide that you need to think about because they're blind spots. I want you to have a brief conversation. This is just a partner chat. Let's get a little more intimate, a little more private. If you don't have an even number of people at your table, you may need to look around and find another partner or You can make a group of three if you need to. But I'm going to give you 4 or 5 minutes to talk about one or more of these things. Could you share an assumption that somebody else has made about you without knowing the truth? There are plenty of people who would look at me at a glance and would think, that guy's not an athlete. Now, in this case, you'd be right. But you don't know. Just made that assumption based on my glasses and my dad bod. Or, if you want, you could share an assumption that you have made about someone else that turned out to not be true. That without knowing, you looked at someone and you were like, oh, I know what this is all about. And then you found out later that you were wrong. Or, if you'd like, you can think about this, zoom out a little bit and think about it from a policy perspective. Are there things that you've seen that are examples of policies or decisions made by organizations, schools, companies, that you think, oh man, they really missed on that one? They thought they knew and made an assumption about the impact of this, and they were really mistaken. One more time, where's my Dungeons and Dragons people in the room? I know there's some of you in here and you don't want to self-identify, that's okay. But right now there is some hot mess going on the internet. If you're playing Dungeons and Dragons, you're also on Reddit, I just assume. It's fair, right? Sorry, I'm making assumptions. But Wizards of the Coast, who owns the intellectual property of Dungeons and Dragons, set their customer base on fire earlier this week when they announced that they were gonna roll out a change to their licensing agreement. And they are getting just torn to shreds about it right now. They thought they knew what the reaction would be. They made some assumptions about the community and that it would just kind of accept this change. And whoops, their subscriptions went in a week. So maybe you want to talk about a business decision. Maybe you want to talk about a school policy. Maybe you want to make it personal. But either way, I want you to find a partner right now. I'm going to give you 2 minutes for just a quick chat. Let's talk about it. All right, friends, I'm gonna pull you back to me for a moment. I hope you'll continue having conversations like this. So obviously, we're just doing a little snippet here in our time together. Just so you know, what we're talking about in here today is just a slice of a much deeper module that we get into, but it is pulled directly from one of our executive development programs. So what you're getting today to experience is part of what senior leaders that we support go through as we explore these topics. We're trying to help them make better decisions. This is one of the tools that we like to share with them. So what we've been talking about up to this point was that first step. Can we get ourselves to a place where we've slowed down and reflected enough, opened our eyes enough to recognize that we have biases that may be blind spots? And pull them into conscious, pull them into a place where we are looking at them and saying, okay, I guess I have been making decisions in this way, that this experience I've had or this perspective I had has been shaping my decisions. The next step, and what this tool is for, is to start to tear those biases apart and ask ourselves, does this make sense? Is this based on valid information? Or is it unsound? And could I be making better decisions? So the ladder of inference is a visualization of how our brains process information and store it over time, how some of these biases get created and how they affect our behaviors and our beliefs. Is it hard science? No, it's just visualization, okay? But follow along with me and see if this feels familiar to you. So at the bottom of the ladder, we have all the data that we observe. And this is actually a great example, right? We've got very meta here for a second. But my brain right now, standing on stage, looking at several hundred faces in the room, is taking in all of this information at the same time, right? My eyes are like video cameras and all of it is getting observed. However, my conscious mind can only pay attention to little samples of this information. In other words, I can't gloss my eyes over and see all of your faces at once. Instead, I have to look at one face at a time. I have to make eye contact with individuals or look over at this table. And each time I do, what my brain is doing is taking from the broad population a sample of information and paying attention to it. And your brain does this all the time. So we are selecting data out of the set. This is the first place we can run into problems. Because if I select data in the right way or the wrong way, depending on how you think about it, it could lead me to really incorrect conclusions. So if I look around the room and every face I stop on, right, out of the several hundred of you in here, if I stop on 5 or 10 faces and all of those faces look disinterested or are buried in a phone or are literally folded over on the table taking a nap, that selection of data now is the pool I'm going to evaluate. And it might lead me to interpret some meaning from it, right? I'm going to look at that sample set and say, what does this mean? And what is it going to mean if I see a whole bunch of people not paying attention? It's going to mean, I guess people aren't engaged in this presentation, right? It's a reasonable meaning to take from a sample like that. And then my brain is going to make some assumptions. And those assumptions are based on some of the biases that we have. Based on my lived experience, if I've got a room of people that's not engaged in the presentation, there's a short list of reasons that might be the case. It could be the content, it could be the environment, it could be me. And I'm going to make a decision in my brain. And I may come to the conclusion, I may draw the conclusion that I am bombing. Anybody ever bomb a presentation before? You know what this feels like? I have. I've been doing this 23 years. I've bombed more than one. It hurts. It's not fun. But if my brain comes to the conclusion that I'm bombing this presentation, it's going to lead me to make certain kinds of decisions. It's going to affect what I do next. Even more dangerous, though, is after this happens more than once, conclusions can turn into beliefs. If we repeatedly draw the same conclusion in similar circumstances, at a certain point, those things become socialized into us, remember that term? And they become beliefs, they become a part of our worldview. And now I might come to believe that I am not an effective presenter, that this isn't the right career for me, that when I get up on stage, I bomb and people check out. And guess what? If I adopt that belief, I will probably take actions based on it. I might start looking for a career change. I might avoid opportunities like this rather than seek them out, to my detriment. The other danger of this cycle is that it is a cycle. It's not a one-way street, because in addition to driving your actions and your choices, your beliefs also come back down the ladder and impact how you select data and impact how you interpret meaning from that data. So if I've decided I'm a bad presenter, the next time I get up, what kind of faces is my brain going to be hunting for in the crowd? The really excited ones or the ones I can tell are disengaged? Probably the latter. Conformity bias kicks in and my brain starts reinforcing what I've already decided is true, that I'm not good at this. And so I'm going to look for evidence in the crowd to support it. Now I'm selecting bad data. And now you can see why some of these beliefs, stereotypes, and biases get embedded in our brains and so hard to remove. So how do we use this as a tool? Well, the way we coach leaders to use this is to work backwards through the ladder. So take a belief that you have about the world and then challenge yourself to move down the ladder. So I was talking to a leader the other day who had decided that one of the executives on her team wasn't a fit for the organization and needed to go. And she had all kinds of reasons why that was the case. I said, okay, so you believe that he's got to go? And she said, yes. I said, okay, what conclusions did you come to over time that led you to that belief? Give me the trail of decisions that led to that point. And we talked it through. And then I said, okay, what assumptions were you making when you came to that conclusion? Right? You're talking about this leadership meeting where he went off the handle. What assumptions were you making in that moment about the why behind his behaviors? We talked that through. And we worked further and further down the ladder until we got to the place where she was able to say specifically, here is the thing he said, or here is the interaction that I observed that to me felt like data that supports all of this, that ends with the belief and potential action that he's going to get terminated. And in the end, what she came to recognize was, number one, there was a lot less data than it felt to her like there was. And number two, there were three or four possible different interpretations of some of those situations that she hadn't really considered. She was about to exit a very significant part of her leadership team in the C-suite because of how it felt and what she believed. But after some reflection, she was able to look at the data it was based on and say, maybe that's not the case I thought it was. This person also happens to be a lawyer, interestingly. So this is how we use the tool. It takes practice. And so in the last minute or so that I have with you, I want to challenge you with this. Think about some of the things that you might be carrying around as a bias, and think about some of the important decisions you have ahead of you. It might be decisions about personal relationships. It might be decisions about what you're going to study or where you're going to invest your time in the coming years. It might be decisions about who you're going to talk to at the career fair in a little bit. It could be any number of things. But try working your way through this ladder at some point and reverse engineer something that you think you believe and ask yourself why you believe that, what it's built on, where that information came from, and why it feels so real to you. You may discover that what you believe is still what you believe at the end of that, and that's okay. But it's the process of checking that matters. The final story I'll tell you about this is a really simple business example. There's a group of leaders that I coach at an organization in Wisconsin. And during COVID, when a lot of their employee base moved to a work from home model, they got really excited, this executive team, about rolling out a benefit for their employees. And they said, every employee is going to get a $400 stipend, $400 to upgrade their home office environment. They can do whatever they want with it. You can buy a desk, you can upgrade your technology, you can just decorate your home office space, whatever you want to do with it, as long as you can show us that you did something to improve your environment for work at home, we will pay for it. And they were so pumped. And they rolled this out. And in the first week, they got dozens of complaints, and they heard from managers that employees were really frustrated with this benefit. And these executives, in my next conversation with them, were so angry. They were like, people are ungrateful. We just gave everyone $400 for free, for nothing. Like, what could they possibly have to complain about? Entitled, on and on and on, right? And I said, whoa, whoa, whoa. Have you actually read the complaints? Nobody had. Have you talked to any of the managers? Nobody had. When they dug into it just a little bit, guess why people were annoyed? Because the way that you got this benefit was by paying for this stuff yourself and then waiting for a reimbursement to get added to your paycheck 2 to 3 weeks later. Now, for these executives who make six-figure salaries and live very comfortable financial lives, this did not even cross their mind. They never for a moment questioned that it might be a source of pain to an employee to carry an extra $400 on their credit card or checking account or who knows what for a matter of weeks or maybe even a month if the paperwork didn't process fast. For them, that never crossed their mind. But for a lot of their employees, that was a big ask. People were saying in the complaints, thanks for the offer. I can't float 400 bucks week to week. I got bills to pay. Can we do this a different way? And when they finally took a look at it and they realized, oh my gosh, we live in a different financial world than a lot of our employees do, they flipped it and just added 400 bucks to everybody's check and said, go do and tell us how it went. And then people did celebrate and people did send them thank you notes and shower them with praise for being awesome executives. Doesn't always work magically like that, but it's one neat, clean example of how this makes business more effective. Last thing I'll say is, if I can be a resource for you, students, educators, I want to be. This is always a really fun event for me to come and be a part of, and I'm grateful that you invested your time with me today. I want to wish you the best of luck as you start to build your careers. I hope you enjoy your time at the career fair and have safe travels home. Thanks again so much, everybody, for being here. I appreciate it.